Hello and welcome back to Podcastless Praxis. I'm David, my pronouns are he and him.
I'm James, my pronouns are they and them.
I'm Jamie, my pronouns are he and him.
I'm Rob, mine are he and him.
And I'm Alistair, my pronouns are also he and him.
Yay, we're all here, and it's all nuggets.
Yeah.
Yeah, special guest is all nuggets.
We've just rolled out of bed, it's 4 p.m. You're not even going to get dressed today. You're just going to sit around in your pants, put your comfy socks with holes in on, and then you're going to stick some chicken nuggets in the toaster and kick back for the evening before going to bed at 4 a.m.
Yeah, it's the British tapas of episodes.
Yeah.
Because we couldn't find any total standout article, which is more to say Rob didn't send me any in the last week, so there wasn't a backup for Rob not wanting to do the planning this week, and here we are.
If Rob goes on strike, we're fucked.
Well, you see, the problem that I've discovered is I think especially now is because there's no election and everybody's waiting for an election, so all you have is Labour announcing plans that they're not serious about and won't do, and the Tories desperately flailing, and that's not really good fun. So
we'll talk
just
about
kinda
those plans that they're not going to do in a minute.
Yeah. Oh joy.
Yes, it's a delicious beige dinner for all.
Yeah. Mm.
All right, now that we've scared off most of our listeners.
With that, all the possible easy episode titles have been said in the episode now.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we just do it like we did last week and just delete part of it.
Yeah, we edit out the best jokes, and those are only for the episode title.
Yeah. Those are only... Yeah. You might be wondering, what content did we cut out? And it's we will never tell you.
But you could
until
just look at the episode title.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The clues have been there all along.
Yeah. If you lay out every single episode title, it's the first letter of each episode spells out something.
Yeah.
Mr. Listen, I gave you all the clues.
Yeah. Finally, the fucking image on that shows up in the thumbnail for the Google Drive makes sense.
Oh well, right. Well, let's
should we
just
get a
fucking
road under this show?
Yeah, why not?
Right. Well, the first nugget is an exciting update about The Line, which,
ooh,
if you remember, is slated to be about 25.
The Money Line?
No, not the Money Line. The desert.
The Saudi Arabia thing.
It's going to be about 25 feet of city, I think, by this point.
Yeah.
We'll have a mirror down the side of it, a wing mirror, probably.
The Saudis have spent billions and billions of dollars to reinvent a fairground house of mirrors.
How tall
warning,
will
cities,
it be?
Cities in this mirror may be larger than they seem.
How tall will it be? Probably about 7 feet at the rate things are going.
Depends what mirror you're looking in.
Yeah, they haven't significantly downscaled it. But anyway, that's not what the news about. The news is about. The news is that apparently they've sent out death squads to clear the land that they want to build on, with shoot to kill orders if people won't fucking be evicted.
Well,
I mean, they've already killed
that ship.
Yeah, they've already killed a bunch of local natives to that region, who've been protesting the last couple of years.
Yeah, well, not to worry, because the British are on the case.
Oh, and good.
Deputy Prime Minister Oliver Dowden has raised allegations.
What kind of weapons?
No, he raised allegations with the Saudi government that its forces were told to kill for a futuristic city. So there you go.
Yeah, you're only allowed to kill to expand insane settler colonial states, not brown people. Ugh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They were told to kill in the name of a future city is that's the opening cards on an 80s action film that no one rated.
Well, he was quoted as saying that Britain doesn't just endorse Saudi Arabia's Vision 2030. We want to be a part of it. And
of
asked about the report that like they'd been given shoot to kill orders. The Prime Minister's official spokesman confirmed that Mr. Dowden had raised the issue of the treatment of villagers in the construction of the NEOM project in his bilateral meetings while he has been out on this visit.
Oh, well, then that's solved that issue.
He added that the UK had vital economic and national security interests with Saudi Arabia, but no aspect of our relationship prevents us from speaking frankly to them about these sorts of issues. So there you go. So it's all sorted now.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, that's a good news story to open up with. That's right.
Yeah. Britain, the world's moral compass, has succeeded again.
Translation, we've done as little as we possibly can, but also I'd still quite like a job with McKinsey after this, so I'm not going to, like, you know, try too hard.
Yeah. Well, that's
Yeah, cool. It's exciting stuff. To know that Britain is at the forefront of the future like that.
Man, I love being in the forefront of the future. The future's great.
Yeah.
Given the size of the construction we're going for, I guess the Lollipop Guild has rights to be very upset at being displaced.
I don't really know who that's going to continue to fucking...
It will continue to shrink, though, so potentially none of this will actually have happened. Like, as the plan,
the killings
reduce,
will continue until the line improves.
Mm. I think that's domestic policy now, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. So my second nugget was: did you all hear about the Dublin to New York portal?
Oh, yes. Hell ever. Yes. Yeah. Yes. I am so sad now.
Yeah. Well, if people haven't heard of it. Yeah, it's a big Stargate-looking fucking thing. There's one in Dublin and there's one
Richard
in New
Dean
York.
Anderson was there.
They have a webcam and a big telly, and you can see, like, so in Dublin you can see New York and vice versa. And it's there to, like, so that the people of Ireland can give a friendly Irish welcome to the citizens of New York.
To the people who are the most annoying to the Irish.
Yeah.
Somehow fucking managing to beat the British on that in a lot of aspects.
It's been temporarily shut down by Dublin City Council because lads kept mooning it and someone held up a photo of 9/11 on their phone.
Chevron 9/11.
Oh, could you imagine if Osama bin Laden had access to a Stargate?
Also, someone who I'm just gonna take a wild punt was on the American side, held up something with a swastika on it.
It's great. Transnational communication is, you know, it's an important part of what we're doing.
Imagine America implying some sort of fascist response to 9/11. That's really fucked up and weird of them.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's only temporary though, because Dublin City Council announced it would tweak the operation of the portal in response to inappropriate behaviour.
What? How is it going to do that?
While we cannot control all of these actions, we are implementing some technical solutions to address this, and these will go live in the next 24 hours, it said, without specifying the changes.
They're installing an iris.
They're going to run all the service through a big pyramid in space.
Any American who attempts to clamber through is just going to be vaporized. Oh,
the Colonel, we're attempting to beam tits through the Stargate. Close the iris, quick.
Yeah, they're going to put a guy in the warp tunnel between the two locations, and he's going to have to press a big button to, like, fucking beep out any, like, fucking penises people wave at it or something like that.
A chap at eye.
A 9-second delay on the fucking instantaneous video between two locations. Yes, okay. Love to keep the concept working. Great.
Oh, dear.
But yeah, the vast majority of interactions had been positive, the council said.
I would argue that all of them, apart from the Nazi one, had been.
Yeah.
Dance moves have been shared. We've seen families and friends unite, as well as new friendships being made, but it doesn't have sound, as far as I'm aware, so...
No, it doesn't.
So, I think it would be a full state of active war at this point if there was sound.
I know. Cowards. There was even a successful marriage proposal. Like, okay.
It was successfully proposed, or did the other person actually accept?
Someone proposed to the portal.
That's why the Catholics got so bad, Alistair.
The portal offers a window to other cities and is connecting people and cultures in a unique manner. Yeah, because we've never seen a video call before.
Yeah, but Jamie, look, the thing that makes it different is you have to push all of these runes in a certain order and then the big button in the middle.
I suppose, do you know what I mean, though? It's not really unique because we've all had, like, fucking Skype calls where the sound packed up. So it's basically...
Also, I think it's a bit rich to get mad at Dubliners for this as well, though, because, like, you know, they heard it was a show in Hull and they were like, right, okay, yeah, instruction received. So yeah.
I agree. America deserved 9/11. That's what the dog says. What they're really lucky is that Ra didn't come through the gate.
Gives a whole new meaning to up the Ra.
Well, those were my two nuggets, but I've just seen in the sidebar at The Guardian that Russell Brand was baptised in the Thames by Bear Grylls. So.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, reality is a construct, David.
Yeah, I'm not making that up either. I did actually say Bear Grylls, Russell Brand, baptised in the Thames.
Did all the sexual assault allegations wash off along the Thames with him, or are they still clinging to him like a fucking barnacle?
They were eaten by the pollution.
I was just going to say, yeah, maybe the sewage, like, eroded them. I don't think even the mighty, like, cleansing powers of the Thames can stop him from being a cunt, so...
No, doubtful.
Bear Grylls could have just stayed at home and drank his own piss, but I suppose, like, the Thames is, like, you know what I mean? Kind of like a fucking day out for that fucking prick, isn't it? You know what I mean?
Smorgasbord.
Homeopathic,
like when you go to IKEA to get a hot dog or something, you know what I mean? But just, like...
The Thames is his British tapas.
Yeah. It's homeopathic piss drinking. It's actually more powerful because it's diluted.
Do you think he was just trying to bludgeon him to death with the water from the Thames as he baptised him? Because, you know...
I don't think it's that stodgy yet.
Yeah, and I don't think Bear Grylls is that fucking cool either, to be fair.
No. No, definitely not.
No, he's just a
prick. Okay, then.
He's just I really fucking dislike Bear Grylls. Just for various reasons. Just like... Ugh.
Yeah.
I eat bugs. It's like,
anti-piss drinking guy vibe on this podcast, and we stand by it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we've got a
fuck Bear Grylls and fuck Brian Rose.
He's the coward's piss drinker, though, because he runs off to the desert and then claims it's essential. Do you know what I mean? Like, the camera crew wouldn't give me any of the water, so I had to drink this, like, piss that I found or something like that. You know what I mean?
Truckers came through here earlier.
Yeah. You just like don't see bush piss anymore.
It's like the Sechen Dune, but instead of water, it's filled with piss. Generations of Fremen. Oh. One day we will turn the desert yellow and quite acidic.
Oh, right, okay, let's move on to... it's tangentially piss-related in that it's talking about the cops. So, yeah, The Guardian...
Piss on cops, you should do that.
The Guardian have done a very cool and good press release, completely uncritically, both for the cops and the entire military research and development sector. Which we love to see.
Oh, I think I know what this is, but yeah.
Yeah, it's so good.
Police officers in Britain could be armed with Ghostbusters-style devices that fire electromagnetic rays to shut down the engines of e-bikes being used in a crime.
You're missing the critical word backpack there.
Is that, yeah. Man, is Tom Clancy's Future War was a really underrated brand.
No,
I'm glad we're getting it back.
you're all fucking it up, because this is obviously a reference to Chrono Legionnaires from Red Alert 2, and I will not accept any other answers than what this is.
Good news about it.
They're just going to phase those e-bikes out of reality.
Yeah.
I mean, finally a policy proposal that Keir Starmer will stand behind.
Just a massive white void filled with fucking e-bikes and Albert Einstein.
Look, I tell you what, if you get one of those Chrono Legionnaires to 3 chevrons, they're an extremely good value for money unit. So, Keir Starmer all over that. And what's her face? Rachel Reeves, she's the Chancellor at the moment. I can't remember their names. Yeah, her, she'd love it.
We need
erase the poor out of the timeline. They never existed, so they can never have been poor. It'd be great for the ONS.
Yeah, but on the other hand, what if London's ore miners are no longer safe?
Well, you can just get them to
you can use
back
the
to the refinery, and then the terror drone pops right out.
You can use the Chrono Commander to protect them, because while something's being phased out of reality, it's immune to damage.
A little
Red Alert 2 tech tip for you there.
For all you Red Alert 2 heads out there.
Yeah. You think there's still a pro scene?
I really hope so.
I think there is, actually, but...
Get in.
So, good news that the technology is quoted as being months away.
Oh, okay.
You got to save up $2,000 to build a battle lab, and then you'll be able to recruit them. Do you have any idea how much $2,000 is? It's like $200,000. It's ridiculous.
Rob, obviously, you've not had sight of this, but it's being developed with the Defence Science and Technology Lab. Is this good?
Oh, is
I
that
fucking told you.
Wait. That's the DARPA thing that Dominic Cummings set up, because he wanted to get all the freaks in government to do stuff, and this was like his baby. So his baby is like the Ghostbusters backpack. Great.
Yeah.
Finally, London
backpack, but for harassing teens on scooters.
Finally, London is safe from the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man. That's been threatening it for years now.
God, imagine the size of the fucking scooter he would need. The fucking flatbed truck with a pylon stuck on the cab.
The article continues, it would fire an electromagnetic pulse at a vehicle that an officer wants to stop because the rider is suspected of involvement in a crime. The electromagnetic weapon works by tricking the engine into thinking it is overheating, which shuts down the engine and brings the vehicle to a stop. It requires a line of sight to work. They've invented a remote control.
So what a thief would have to do, a clever, you know, e-bike-based thief, is to do the thing that nobody sees coming, which is turn a corner.
Yeah.
Yeah. Famously, they're really bad at that. No chance. That's just not going to work.
I can't wait do you know what I mean? The cops try to get some guy who's going down a pit the opposite side of the street and just take out like a bunch of fucking electric cars or something.
Well, this is a thing. Famously, you can't like aim these things to stop at a particular distance. So if like someone on the other side of the street is on their phone, then that phone's probably getting hit as well. Like
the machine that kills iPhones. Amazing. Yes.
Yeah.
No, it's fine. You set the phaser to stun, and the police can be trusted with this.
Yeah,
it's fine.
They will barely stop any fucking old lady's pacemakers in a like a collateral damage incident.
Oh, Jesus fucking Christ. Yeah, okay, that would do it.
Yeah, so the explanation from the
we trust
the cop
them,
guy
we trust
in charge
them with
of
tasers,
us.
And they've only killed like maybe a dozen people like with those. So
recently,
this is just a taser for bikes. So what's the problem? Other than you know all the problems we just listed.
Yeah, basically, it interferes with the electric motor to trick the electric motor into thinking it is overheating. It sends a signal to confuse the electric motor. All these electric motors apparently have an inbuilt safety system that if it thinks it's overheating, it shuts down.
What I've learned from that sentence is that Tesla haven't built an electric scooter yet.
Yeah, I was just thinking, finally a use case for like the fucking Tesla, you know, fucking truck they've put together. just it's like its angles are designed specifically to deflect this kind of shit.
Yeah.
Its engine, you know, is perpetually overheating, so it can't tell the difference. Like, finally,
the Cybertruck is a mobile tinfoil hat.
Yeah, the cops have to cross the streams, and it still bounces off and takes down a plane.
No, it's back at the Stargate shit. It's like a Zat. You've got to shoot a Tesla twice to kill
it. Oh, Jesus fucking Christ.
The equipment was demonstrated to police leaders at the Farm Technology Show earlier this year. Quote, they were also telling me it has the potential to be useful with normal combustion engine vehicles.
This is just a bit from the fucking Fast and the Furious. I've noticed.
Love my normal combustion engine vehicle.
My large adult combustion vehicle.
Since police you brought up the Fast and the Furious, do you want to mention that incredible fact I told you the other day?
Yeah, actually.
In case you hadn't heard, like, fucking B-movie legend Roger Corman died this week. And I had previously, I was aware that he'd done a film called The Fast and the Furious, and they had to license the rights to use the name for the Vin Diesel, The Fast and the Furious film.
Oh, right.
What I only learned, like, I think yesterday, was he kept the rights to make, like, numbered sequels, which is why none of the Fast and the Furious sequels are just called The Fast and the Furious and then a number. Because, like, he could do that, so that's why they're Too Fast, Too Furious, Tokyo Drift, and so on. Like, Fate of the Furious, fucking Fast great. Five, and etc. Because, like, you know, he still had the rights to just simply The Fast and the Furious, and then a number. Which is, honestly, kind of like some fucking 4D chess right there.
Yeah, that's fucking incredible.
Back to this. Police hope the device will be harmless to humans and other devices.
Oh, the word hope. That's great.
Can you imagine that guy with a fucking Neuralink in his head just happens to be in the blast radius of this shit? Like, momentarily, I mean, honestly, glimpses a face of God.
I don't think his fucking Neuralink needs any encouragement, quite frankly. Like.
the last machine Thor that enters his head before switching off is, you're about to die, and then darkness...
I do love, though, the police hope the device will be harmless.
Yeah. Only one way to find that out, Jamie. Test it in the field.
Rebellions are built on hope.
Oh, fuck yeah.
And then I get stuck trying to rob the quarterly salaries from the Bank of England because my e-bike gets stopped at the border.
Police pursuits have changed from the days of chasing cars on motorways. It's these lightning-fast electric bikes around town and city centres. Really difficult. And then, assumedly, a shaking of the head.
Why can't they just train a squad of, like, e-bike police?
Don't they have them? There's, like, fucking e-bike cops here everywhere.
The e-bike squad.
They absolutely
squad.
Do have them, and they absolutely fall off them all the time. Officer down.
But like, seriously, how many... I none of us live in London. Like, is e-bike based crime a thing in London? Like, are they, you know, are they doing heat style robberies but on e-bikes? Is Val Kilmer shooting his way out again?
It's like petty theft shit. Like, that's the extent of it. No one is carrying out fucking, like, organized bank heists on e-scooters.
It's also, like, it's two times the crime, right? There's the actual snatch and grab crime, but that's just, you know, any vehicle, any bike can do that. The other thing is the regulations on e-bikes being ignored, which is a crime, and the police get very hit up about it. So, that.
The police are just, like chasing them because they all imagine they're fucking Starsky and Hutch, do you know what I mean? I bet the cops just love to get into a fucking car chase.
He's always,
his practice
is always
to paint a bunch of cardboard boxes on a wall to see what happens.
It's always a fascinating venture to see what they'll spend enormous sums of money to develop, like this fucking Chrono Legionnaire backpack thing, versus, to take down fucking e-bikes, right? versus like the thousands and thousands and thousands of push bikes that are stolen that have like a GPS tracker, a GoPro camera live streaming the location of the bike to the owner after it's been stolen, and still, can't do anything, mate. Sorry. This is a better use of money than literally anything that might help someone who actually has problems.
Yeah.
It's the lime. It's everybody's like driving around on lime scooters with little stripy jumpers and one of those like masks that only cover your eyes.
Rob's just discovering what an eye mask is.
I would actually like to see a remake of Heat set in like fucking Sadiq Khan's London though. Val Kilmer coming out, like that shot where he's like, you know, that famous like shot where he's spraying bullets at the cops in two directions and then crouches behind the car to reload. That, but with like a huge fucking rack of knives inside his coat.
Yeah, he pulls out his various zombie knives.
Right, off of cops now and on a different type of cop, it's time for a quick hate of the Labour Party. So this is kind of good news, but obviously the caveat here is going to be, do not trust the Liberals, they will only betray you. Labour had set out last year a new deal for working people.
That sounds awesome, David. What sort of great reforms did they have?
They had a bunch of middle of the road, slightly better than things are now, but still not close enough to do anything remotely fixing of today's problems.
And then they immediately rolled them all back to impress business.
Well, in the original agreement, some of the measures in it were higher sick pay, ending fire and rehire, banning of 0-hour contracts, and granting of day one rights. Rather than the fucking 2 years or some shit you need to wait.
Yeah, for. So not bad shit. You know, like acceptable shit.
Not bad
shit.
Not far enough, but not bad.
Curbing of the absolute worst excesses of the current fucking system.
Well, they were going to roll a bunch of them back internally until a bunch of it got leaked and the union started to get mad and pissy about it. Like, Sharon Graham printed off the words fire and brimstone and pointed at it. Like, but that was as close as we got to anything actually.
I'm quaking in my tiny booties if I'm Keir Starmer that, you know, the unions will at long last do something. It's gonna happen any day now, boys.
Have you considered, though, that Keir Starmer is the biggest rube of them all and they actually went, oh, okay, we won't do anything like that and they're not going to roll anything back now, apparently. Obviously, that's what they're saying now. It's for union funding during the election. It'll all get rolled back as soon as they're fucking in, if such a thing were to happen, which it won't. But the ways that they were downgrading this shit is what I want to go into. So fire and rehire was going to be solved by, quote, replacing the inadequate statutory code brought in by the government with a strengthened code of practice and reform the law to provide effective remedies against abuse. So in other words, the same shit but different. Okay, fine. There was also a part about how they wouldn't like have it be totally codified against because it is important businesses can restructure to remain viable when there is genuinely no alternative.
If you run a business that cannot afford to give your employees sick pay, holiday pay, decent contracts, you are not a viable business.
You
Fuck
suck
you.
Shit.
This is capitalism. Yep. You deserve to die if you suck.
Yep, you entered into the marketplace of survival of the fittest, so go fuck yourself. If a company is faced with changing terms and conditions or mass redundancies, then there needs to be an exception to protect jobs. Protecting jobs is always the final priority. Even Barry Gardiner in his private member's bill on fire and rehire practices had similar exemptions. Oh, well, if Barry Gardiner said, then we must all be on board, you fucking prick.
Voice of the working man, Barry fucking Gardiner, is it today?
Yeah, the fact of the matter is, the jobs are a number that has to be high. Like, any adjectives you might append before that word Those are all included. So it doesn't matter if they're dog shit awful jobs that no one in their right mind would want to work in for longer than 10 minutes. But that job is still a job.
Well, yeah. On the note of dog shit jobs that no one wants, Zero Evil's contracts. They were initially going to ban them outright, and they rolled this back to making them optional. I don't know how that was going to work in practice. There was no explanation of exactly how that would work in practice. Yeah.
No, yeah, there was. There was. They said a thing. They said what we're going to do is, like, if you're on a 0 hours contract, then, like, you, like, it's between you and your employer, or, like, your employer has the right to give you one for, I think it was, like, 12 weeks, so, like, 3 months. And then after that, like, you and your boss could just, like, have a sensible negotiation between the two of you as to, you know, whether or not that would remain. And I think that's a very sensible way of going about it.
And that's why fire and rehire is still allowed then, is it?
Yeah, if there's one thing we, if there's one thing we've learned from every single industrial dispute over the last, like, 200 years of labor relations, it's that the boss and the employee are both equal unto God, therefore there is no power imbalance between the two.
Well, it's not the fire and rehire bit that would be the problem there. It's the day one rights. So the initial proposals, the ones that they have said they'll do, but they probably won't anyway because you can't trust the cunts, would give you sick pay, parental leave, and protection against unfair dismissal from day one.
Okay.
They were going to roll back the unfair dismissal part.
I do love that the corollary of this is that until now you could be unfairly dismissed and fuck you.
Yeah. Well, it's fine. It's not technically unfair dismissal because it's the probationary period would still be allowed. So
yeah, so you
they
have
could
no
just
rights.
Fucking sack you. Yeah. Yep. So cool. That's what they want. That's what they'll do. They've said they won't now, but can you trust Keir Starmer and his pledges? I think not.
Well, I mean, let's set a bet, shall we? I bet £5 by the time this episode is released that they've reversed on this fucking pledge.
Yeah.
And it is currently the 14th of May. So let's see if Keir Starmer reverses his pledge by the time this episode comes out.
Yeah. There was a few of them at the meeting. Fucking Rayner was there, Starmer was there. It was all the union heads. Annalise Dodds somehow found time to be there around her busy meetings with the LGB Alliance.
Did someone stick a quid in her then?
Yeah. constructive discussions with the LGB Alliance. Said the LGB
remember
Alliance.
Remember when she was like put in as party chairman or but no shadow chancellor? Like
she was the shadow chancellor before.
She was the shadow chancellor. Like as if
that. she was like put in as like a compromise position, and she was strongly pushed for by John McDonnell because he said no, she'll she'll keep our legacy intact. She will.
Oh yeah, sure, mate. Okay.
Of the socialist campaign group at work yet again.
Was it change.org? Does she love a petition, does she? Okay, mate.
Just fucking pathetic. Next up, war.
Sorry!
Sorry, David got held up. No, keep rolling. I've got my notes. One take and we're out. Hi, you're listening to a free episode of Podcasting's Praxis. But did you know that Kurosawa was 51 when Yojimbo was released, widely hailed... Sorry, unrelated. But did you know that we also do premium episodes? That's right. Each month, the CIA was backing death squads in a... No. It's fine, we'll fix it in post. Each month we post exclusive episodes on our Patreon, which you can join at patreon.com/praxiscast. Joining our Patreon also gets you access to our Discord, where you can find bonus clips and unzip the optional physics files into your Skyrim data for... Hang on. Where there are bonus clips, and you can... Wait, David, it's fine, I'm nearly done.
What is it good for? Are we finally finding out?
It is good for driving clicks to the Daily Mail website, because that's what happened to us.
It's good for getting Daily Mail readers up the runway.
really keen to show off how its interactive graphic reveals how the West will stop putting Unleashing Armageddon with nukes at Russia's doorstep, mass conscription at 18, and arms factories firing up.
Oh god, so hard, isn't it?
Like nukes at Russia's doorstep is what kicked this whole fucking thing off. Like, Jesus
Christ.
Yeah,
but they'll learn this time.
But his whole thing was, look, if Ukraine isn't neutral, you're gonna park nukes in Ukraine, and I don't want nukes on my doorstep, so fuck you all. Like, that's where this came from.
But, right, he is, like, an evil fucking, like, cartoon emperor from Star Wars, and also
and a communist.
And also has gay sex with Donald Trump. So, you know, we can't, like, fucking not put the nukes there now just because he said so.
I saw the whole thing.
Haven't you spoken to a single American liberal about this?
I have, unfortunately. I saw this repeating talking point, which is that he's 71 and his greatest ambition is to rebuild the USSR before he dies. And it's like, oh my god. Like, this is also
one of my ambitions, but in a different way.
I mean, but like, he's thoroughly opposed to the USSR. He fucking hated it when it was a thing.
Everyone who was in the KGB was in the KGB because they loved communism. It's that simple.
Oh, it's fucking
miserable. Did you hear this? Did you hear this shit about Estonia saying they were thinking of deploying their troops, NATO troops, to serve the back lines of Ukraine's army so that Ukraine could deploy more troops to the front line? As though that's gonna trick the Russians into thinking that NATO is not involved. Like, what?
And also, just so we can send more fucking Ukrainians into the meat grinder. Great.
Yeah.
Which sounds like it's going great, guys.
Was it Germany or Poland? It was one of the two. I can't remember. But they actively started sending back the good old fighting age males to Ukraine.
Yep,
if they had
Poland.
Ukrainian citizenship. Ooh. Fucking quality, good stuff, yeah.
Remind me again what a fighting-aged male consists of. Is it it's like any man or any boy between the ages of like 15 and like 65, right?
I don't know what Ukraine's classing it as now, but I know that it started at 18 and it's not 18 any longer.
No, it's not. It's 16 last I heard, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's lower.
17 to 45, says Quora.
Oh, great. Fantastic. Also, Poland has a
ChatGPT says that it must be true.
Poland has a complicated relationship with Ukraine. Poland doesn't like Ukraine, like, full stop, just as a general rule. There's been unrest because of Ukrainian refugees that came into Poland, and they're still, like, they hate Russia more. So this is kind of a win-win for them. They get to offload Ukrainians who they don't particularly like to go kill Russians who they really don't like. So, yeah, awesome. I love Poland's winning. I love to be spiraling closer and closer to a third world war because no one has the sense to go, hey, maybe we should do peace talks and come up with some settlement for an actually neutral Ukraine.
James, don't you know Jeremy Corbyn was saying that there should be a negotiated peace? That sounds awfully, awfully like giving in to Russia.
By God, is that Paul Mason's music?
Because as we all know, every geopolitical conflict has always ended with one side being completely annihilated and the other side being the last one standing.
I mean, have we considered deploying the Stargate teams to Russia, to the front?
Unfortunately, they count as NATO troops, so we can't do that. The Daily Mail, though, there's some real fucking gems in here that have been written down. Britain will be in a war economy by the end of the decade. They define a war economy as spending 2.5% of GDP on war.
Okay, like, so
GDP
no
on
commanding...
war or defence? What?
War is defence, defence is war.
Isn't that what the fucking NATO pledge is?
No, NATO pledge is 2%.
Oh, is it 2%?
Yeah, that's what, because mean Trump was fucking doing his thing about people not putting enough money in and how he was going to up military spending or whatever when he was president, and it was because no one was putting in the 2% they were supposed to under NATO agreements, because everyone realised that actually you can just fuck that shit off and it doesn't matter. and that the money could be better spent elsewhere to some degree. But obviously we're abandoning that now.
Yeah, I mean, if you cancel your subscription to a service and they would just continue giving you the service anyway, why would you pay the subscription? Although I do seem to keep receiving emails from the Labour Party, so much to think about.
There's also the whole conscription end of things. Germany is looking to bring it back, which I'm sure we can all agree historically has been a great thing.
They're not going to fucking do that. This Germany. Is like we've read that fucking. This is like that. It's just like, you know. It's like, what if Sam Payne was German? This is like somebody just like proposing to bring national service back. Yeah. It's like, it's not fucking.
Look, I don't know.
David, I'll do him a deal. They can have back national service and conscription if they partition Germany again.
Yes. Yes. In one proposal being considered by military planners in Berlin, all men and women would be subject to conscription once they turned 18, provided a constitutional amendment to include women in mandatory service is passed.
Oh, okay. So any
women
now.
War crimes. And then this was obviously another opportunity for British generals to start harping on about how actually we should have some sort of national service shit. Remember we talked about that.
Yes.
The chief of defense staff was like, everyone should have be like some sort of like citizen soldier or some weird bullshit. There's another guy who was like a NATO commander formerly, and he wants all 18-year-old males specifically for some reason to do 6 to 12 months of military service and then be considered reservists until they're 60. Getting called up 40 years after the last time you've seen a fucking rifle and expecting to be useful or compliant. Fuck off.
The bullets still come out the same end, right?
Yeah. It's like me at 55 being handed, you know, the backpack gun to stop the Vladimir Putin e-bike. And it's like, but I trained with an Enfield. Like,
do you think you can mount that fucking backpack on top of an Ajax?
There's enough electromagnetic energy coming off an Ajax to just disable all vehicles local to it, including itself. What else was in? Oh yeah, fans of Border Gore will also enjoy the unfortunately non-interactive graphic that they have that splits the Arctic into a disputed area between Russia, the USA, Canada, and Greenland brackets Denmark. The major players.
All the genders, really.
Yeah, it's a fun article. It's like a little microcosm of just the worst shit, and it's good. Just briefly, while it's still my turn, there's also a Telegraph article I found. I say article, but it was in the money / tax section, titled "Classic Socialist Spite: Telegraph Readers Vote for Britain's Worst Chancellor." Can you guess who it was? Who was the worst chancellor in the last 30 years?
I know who it was, because now comment to commentary, it's going to get slightly shorter.
Some absolute fucking belters. There's so many responses.
Well, I'll read the one I had then. Gordon Brown's wrecking of the private pensions industry was classic socialist spite. His selling off of our gold reserves truly idiotic, and his failure to foresee the 2008 crisis was pathetic.
Yeah, commentary.
The two biggest things for me about Brown are the doubling in the tax code and selling our gold at rock bottom prices.
I was going to ask when somebody's going to mention the gold. Yes, 100%. Yeah,
gold mentioned.
Yeah. I once read a comment that said the Scottish dwarf sold off our gold, and I was like, "That's a mixed metaphor if ever I've heard one."
The names are fucking incredible as well. There's a Canute Turner for sheer malice against any private sector worker with a few savings. Brackets private pension raids 10% tax starting below starvation level. general incompetence bracket selling off the gold reserves at giveaway prices, and for piling complexity on complexity until even HMRC didn't know what was going on, Mr. Brown has to take it by a length.
I like that there was an honourable mention given to Alistair Darling for bringing in 60% tax band.
Fuck off.
Can you imagine?
The complaints about the Tory ones are quite good as well. George Osborne's alleged austerity was just pure nonsense.
Alleged austerity?
It's alleged austerity.
Those hundreds of thousands who died as a result of austerity were just work shy, I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Read the one about Sunak and fucking and the eat out to help out thing.
Eat out to help out and bounce back loans thrown around like confetti means Sunak is by far the worst chancellor. Oh.
Do you know the thing about that?
Commented by Winker Watson. How any poll cannot make Kwasi Kwarteng the worst chancellor is beyond me. The only good thing about his stewardship was that he didn't last very long. Thank you, Winker.
And thank you to you, David.
Yeah, I was thinking of a different quote about Sunak, and it might actually have been a comment under the article, but there was one that said, like, fucking... there was one that said, like, fucking, you know what I mean, COVID and, like, the COVID pandemic was no, like, was no excuse.
Oh, yeah, that
to...
one's here. That one's here. COVID was not a valid excuse to spend billions paying healthy people to not work.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to wonder, well, what is their alternative?
Yeah.
It's so good, though, isn't it? It's like, just put those people back in the office, then they'll not be healthy. It's like, well, fuck, pay them to stay home. But then they'll be healthy. Well, we can put them in the fucking office. Do you know what I mean?
We need to find the exact point at which the person is both at work, but not at work, but healthy, but not too unhealthy. And it's some at some point on your commute, you're in the sweet spot.
Yeah, feeling the a COVID bit queasy on the bus.
Mr. Osborne destroyed the dreams of home ownership, especially with Section 24.
Oh my God.
Section 24 was the thing that allowed quote expenses around rental properties to be claimed pre-tax. So they now have to like put their gross fucking income as part of their fucking takings. And that ruined the dream of home ownership.
Oh, boo-hoo.
No wonder we have homelessness going through the roof.
What was the full quote on that one, though? Because didn't that mention, like, something about fucking... We have homelessness going through the roof because people are leaving the buy-to-let industry.
Yeah, rents will continue to rise as landlords leave the market. That doesn't make any sense.
They're just taking down the houses. They're just flattening them out again. They're packing them away, you know. Like, if a landlord leaves, then the landlord is with them. It's famously established.
When a landlord decides to quit the industry, they like take the last month's rent you paid them, hire a chrono commando to make the house disappear.
whenever a buy to let mortgage is issued, a landlord gains their wings.
Anyway, that's my stuff. That's all I've got. So over to you, Alistair.
Well, hang on. Before you do, that comment about, you know, the alleged austerity, just for record, there is a noticeable statistical difference in child height as a consequence of austerity. Britons are shorter because of austerity, and it's directly along class lines. Like,
I think you'll find Britons are so-called shorter.
Jesus Christ, yeah.
Is that why they want to change, like, you know, just get rid of everything metric, you know, just to, like, essentially decrease the numbers so people won't be able to tell the difference? Like, just fuck all of this. Fuck them all. They're disingenuous arseholes, the lot of them.
There's more space to group a section of the population within an inch than there is in a centimetre, so, yeah, that makes sense.
I've got more cop stuff for you, but this time it's border cops.
Yay!
There's
somehow
gonna be a
shitter
vote.
Type of cop.
Yeah, there's going to be a vote at the PCS union, which represents border cops.
Oh, sorry.
Across Britain. across the UK rather. If the ballot goes to a strike, it wouldn't cover Scotland for some reason. But you know, England, Wales, Northern Ireland would all be on strike for a number of days. And
where would we get our crime numbers, Alistair?
Well, you're going to have to turn to the army, who would be brought in to... Yes, that's right. You're going to get a cop a soldier who is trained for 1 week to become a plastic PC behind the Perspex box where you have to show your passport. But the thing, I call them a plastic PC because they wouldn't even have the power to detain someone for a suspected criminal activity, like having a fake passport, trying to cross a border without, right documents, etc. So they'd have to go and find an actual border cop in order to get them to arrest or detain the suspect, which is...
You know, Alistair, I'm just now realizing that the line from Children of Men, Britain soldiers on, was actually just purely descriptive. Because that is the fucking solution to everything, isn't it? Just get these fucking, like, just get a bunch of squaddies, give them like a week's training, and they'll be able to do anything.
Yeah.
Fine. I mean, it worked perfectly during COVID.
Get those stout lads in to yeet passports. is there 1 week of intensive training, like getting them to play through... Papers, Please.
Papers, Please.
Yeah, you have to get to the end of Papers, Please, otherwise you're out. But the thing I really enjoyed about this story is the MOD received a request for military aid from the Home Office, asking them to bring a destroyer and some frigates down to Heathrow, just to make sure that the passports are being scanned properly. There was an admiral, Sir Tony Radakin, which sounds like a Star Wars
Fuck
character,
off.
who previously told the government off for thinking that the military could just step in whenever cops go on strike, whenever firefighters go on strike, things like that.
Still try to fucking train them how to operate trains.
I looked into the like exams and stuff that you have to do to become a train driver at one point because it's just fucking insane, like the level of like attention to detail you need to be able to have, presumably to see the very fast things that are moving on rails, I guess. Like you'd know where you'd get like, you know, some spotty 18-year-old to be able to pay attention to something for more than 30 seconds. So this is also the second time that border guards have been covered for by the army since 2022. where I think it was... So more than 600 armed forces personnel were used to cover for striking workers at the borders in 2022. And they were given 5 days of training then. And brought in to take people's passports, I'm sort of reading from the article now, and check them against the Warnings Index, a Home Office watchlist database with information such as previous immigration history and matters of national security.
Yeah, Papers, Please.
Yeah.
Yes, you need to have the right stamps, you need to have a passport that isn't just a poorly drawn image of your own face that you have put in there with a ballpoint pen. Ideally. What we also need to remember is the armed forces can't strike. So like if you're a private parts, you are being paid less than the border cops who you're replacing, and your pay hasn't kept up with inflation at all.
It is really like one of my absolute favorite things about like the British states, like just absolute like 1000% commitment to like austerity, is that they just look at the corps and the army and go, no, you guys have to go as well. Like it really is like just like, you know, everywhere else they're at least smart enough, like when they cut everything else, it's just like to give the guys with the big epaulets more money because you're gonna need them.
America gives their corps the like surplus fucking AMRAPs and all that shit to LAPD because of all the mines that protesters bring with them.
Yeah. As a treat, we should give British cops the Ajax.
And then eventually you just have all of the entire police force in the UK into one single vat of homogenous liquid, which I think we can all agree is an ideal outcome.
Consolidate all of your law enforcement into one large drinkable thing.
Our cops are juiced, David.
They will be after this.
Experiments pending. Real world data required.
So yeah, in summary, border cops are bad, but when they strike, at least the outcomes are very funny.
Yeah, do it more often.
Yeah. You always be on strike. I don't care who you are, just be on strike.
Yeah. Work bad. As an example of work bad, we're going to stop doing anything now other than comment or commentary, and we're going to call it a short one because it can't be fucked. Nobody
wants it's the start of heat badness season, and quite frankly, it's 25 degrees here today.
It is so fucking humid here. Oh my god.
We had a right proper thunderstorm here the other day, and for the record, there was a lightning strike, and one of my neighbor's houses caught fire. So just normal things. Loving the climate here.
It's good. Still fucking humid though. Anyway, comment or commentary. Let's go.
All right. How much is Europe paying the UK to defend them? It's just that if Putin wanted to take on Europe without the UK defending it, then he simply has to annihilate France and the rest would be a walk in the park. We all know that Russia has the largest military force and that France and UK are second and third, but did you know that after that it is Turkey that has the fourth largest military? Is that comment or commentary?
Comment.
I'm not sure it's correct, actually.
Wait, is that in Europe? Good luck. I mean, is Turkey in Europe? Someone page Sinan.
I mean, does it lust for Europe? Yes. Is it in Europe? Disputed.
But that very much depends.
Is it in
who
Europe soon?
Yeah, it's much like the line. It's like Zeno's European membership. Anyway,
commentary.
Bit weird to call the Turkish Zenos, but it's
oh fuck off, you nerd.
I don't think, James, you have a fucking leg to stand on calling other people nerds. But
no, it just makes it worse.
Yeah, game recognized game.
Yeah.
Well, that was a comment in the Daily Mail. And it was from the article David mentioned about the war.
Excellent. I'm glad I didn't finish scrolling down on that then.
Yeah. Like Russia, China, North Korea, and Iran, Apple wants to crush our way of life to make room for its own. And it is much, much better at it. Is that comment or commentary?
What is Apple's way of life? Is that like taking fruit enemas instead of getting cancer treatment?
It's just, you know, woke, soy, the usual, like.
Yeah, they think Apple is evil in the weird, fucking conspiracy theory sense and not in the, like, blatant capitalist greed sense. It's like, okay, dude.
This sounds demented enough that I'm going to say commentariat.
I hope it's commentariat.
I'm going to say comment. Because this is one of those things that could be... I mean, and the whole fucking point of this game. It could be an article in an insane publication or a comment in a less insane one. So...
commentariat.
Comment.
That was Giles Corran in the Times. The column was titled, "An Apple a Day Keeps the Doctor Away? Not These Days."
Fuck off.
What does that mean? Actually, no. Don't speak to me, Giles.
Do not perceive the mind
means,
of
It
Corn.
Means if you eat an iPhone every day, your doctor will just, like, leave you alone.
I mean, to be fair, they've been leaving me alone out of their own free will up until this point.
Is this Giles Corran's way of telling us how he got the heavy metal poisoning. Oh.
this is Giles Corwin trying to book a GP appointment.
Sewage Island claims more victims. Brexit incompetence get nothing done. Just chaos, disease, and corruption. Time to elect a competent patriot as PM, Sir Starmer. Oh, no Brexit, no demagoguery, no fuss. Happy days ahead.
Fuck
is that off. Comment or commentary?
Marina Hyde in
comment
The Guardian.
Guardian.
Jonathan Friedland in The Guardian.
I think we can all agree, whatever the fuck this is, it's from The Guardian.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that was a comment in The Express.
What? What are you doing out of your enclosure?
All right, last one. I never buy kindling, though they try to bundle it in when you buy your winter firewood, preferring to chop it with an axe on a block in the front garden. Because if I didn't, I'd never use my axe. Is that comment or commentary?
Dude's rock, I guess.
What? I'm so confused right now.
I've got to give this one a dude's rock, I'm afraid.
Yeah. comment Barstool Sports.
That's gotta be commentariat.
Yeah, commentariat. Let's go with that.
Yeah, that was Giles Corran again in the Times. from a column about the decline of manual transmission in cars.
Jesus fucking.
This life on automatic is driving us to ruin.
Oh, fuck off. You're only allowed one Corran a week.
A Corran a day keeps a podcaster away, I'll have you know.
Right, okay, that'll do us. If I wasn't fucking ready to finish this podcast early before, I definitely am now. So, you can get episodes, which are typically longer than this one, at patreon.com/praxiscast, which you won't have heard before. You should do that. They're very good. Also, they're very bad. And there's bonus clips available in the Discord, which you'll also get access to as well. twitch.tv/praxiscast, if this releases on time, big fucking if, who knows. Consult a fucking chrono commando, if not. 7:30 or whatever fucking time we do it, Helldivers 2 will be played on Twitch. twitch.tv/praxiscast. And merch available, praxiscast.tmail.com. Bye.
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 See ya.
Bye.